Hello and welcome to the Clan Show, your one-stop shop for all Clan fans. I'm going for a nighttime bike ride with Ben Davies, why not? And I'll also be talking to a Hollywood star who's a big fan of the Clan. We'll also have a very cold photo shoot with Tristan Harper to show you, and we'll have all your regular messages on the message board. However, first up, let's have a little recap at the month it was for the Braehead Clan.
Well, there's no denying it's been a difficult February for the Clan. It started horrendously on Saturday, the 6th of February, with a 5-3 defeat against the Panthers in Nottingham. It also stripped the team of Captain Keith and Scotty Pitt through injury. The next night back in Braehead wasn't much better, as a depleted Clan side were 3 goals down before they knew what hit them. The boys did manage to draw level, but it wouldn't be enough as the Flyers stole a decisive 4th. Thursday the 11th, an even more depleted Clan roster hosted the Edinburgh Capitals. Reinforcements were called up. Jordan Cowney returned from Milton Keynes. Assistant coach Richard Hartman got 3 big points, and Solway Sharks, Stuart Kerr and Duncan Spears performed admirably, with the latter grabbing a big goal on his Clan debut. A Manchester Storm doubleheader followed next. First, Saturday the 13th proved unlucky for Clan as they were sunk 4-1 in Altrincham. Then the next night wasn't much better. Despite taking a lead in the first through a big Jackman slap shot, the Storm battled back and held out for a 2-1 road victory. Injuries, suspensions and international call-ups really taking their toll. Saturday the 20th, and the Clan again hosted a confident 5 Flyers, who brought through a big travelling support to see their side record a big 5-1 victory. Some real slick passing and clinical finishing, particularly from TJ Keg, was too much for the Clan and some of their fans, who couldn't watch anymore. The next night was more disappointment, as the Clan went down 2-1 on the road to Dundee, a result that severely damaged the Clan's conference title hopes. Saturday the 27th, Captain Keith Scott Pitt back in the lineup. Keith even scored a cheeky wee welcome backhander. But the Giants came back hard and capped off a professional performance with an empty netter for 5-2. There was, however, a silver lining. The very next night, the Nottingham Panthers were in the building for a brutal encounter that saw Jansen and Keith ejected from the game. Despite being a goal down, Clan went on to win 5-3, courtesy of a Scotty Pitt hat-trick, his second in particular being a lovely driven shot.
And finally, an excellent road trip weekend, as the Clan first defeated the Giants 2-1 in Belfast. Brooks with a shorthanded goal for his 21st of the season, and Alex Levitt with his 22nd. Then on to Dundee for a vital conference match. The same scoreline, Marcus Gotts with a big slap shot, giving the Clan an all-important regulation time winner.
Hey, man. How you doing?
How you doing?
It's good. It's good stuff.
Oh, that's aggressive.
Have you been waiting long?
Yeah, I've been waiting. Well, when I got here, it was the summers I was training, and so it was about an hour and a half. It's pitch black now. So.
It's the best time. It's the best time to go cycling. Yeah, it's the most romantic.
Oh, I thought it'd be a bit dangerous.
No, it's the safest, statistically the safest time. We're not overstimulated.
Really? I thought you'd be a little old to go cycling in the dark.
All right, okay. What, you expect me to turn up on the first ever bike in a penny farthing or something?
But actually, it was called a dandy horse, and it was Baron Carl van Drees presenting to the public in 1817. So,
wow,
kind of really, wasn't a penny farthing.
Yeah, got that wrong. That was really specific cycling knowledge.
Yeah, well, I know a little bit.
Well, should we go then? Yeah. I've been put in my place.
Okay. Let's do it. My name's Ben Davies. I wear number 5 for the Braehead Clan. How I describe myself is a highly skilled player, extreme goal scorer, and power play specialist when I'm out on the ice. I'd describe myself as a hard worker, try and create plays, and just chip in with goals whenever I can. Bicycle, bicycle, bicycle. I want to ride my bicycle, bicycle, bicycle. I want to ride my bicycle. I want to ride my bike. I want to ride my bicycle. I want to ride it where I like. Hey, man, let's say. Let's have a little break up here, eh?
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, yeah.
Cracking.
This'll do. Knackered. Oh, beautiful time. Beautiful time of night, though, eh? Getting to see everything.
Oh, yeah.
It's absolutely beautiful.
Views are gorgeous at night.
Oh. You can see the stars, even though Alistair's put up his big light there.
Oh, so you can.
It's great.
Oh, yes. Right in my back there.
Fantastic.
Yeah. Oh, it's nice, isn't it? Well, now that we're taking a little breather, can you tell us a little bit about how you first got into hockey then? You always ask the Canadian guys and they're like, I'm Canadian, but the British guys usually have a slightly different route into hockey. What was yours?
Yeah, well, mine was basically living in Cardiff, and the rink was in town and I didn't live too far away. My parents took me and my little sister once. We went just public skating.
Just skating? Aye.
Yeah, and I guess I enjoyed it from there. And
what age were you then?
I think I was six.
Six, wow, yeah, I mean, that is the early start.
I was still young, yeah. So I guess I enjoyed it. We queried skating lessons, and yeah. I started them, and then within 6 months, I think I was doing the hockey lessons and started from obviously a low level and moved my way up to the juniors.
So
and
at then, six, like 6 and 7, I think you six, started yeah. actually playing hockey then? Because yeah. in the UK, that's really young, isn't it?
To yeah, I was kind of lucky that I got into the sport pretty early, and then moved into the junior system and was moving my way up through the junior ranks in Cardiff for years. And
did you ever dabble any other sides of hockey, the kind of figure skating bit or anything like that, or the kind of
no,
public skating?
No, it was just the 6 months of skating lessons before I got into the hockey side. But yeah. I'd done the, a couple of years later, I'd done the roller hockey for a couple of years, and I was doing field hockey for years.
Yeah.
Like, I'd done that for a little longer than roller hockey after, but...
Because for guys in the UK, that seems to be the hard bit, that kind of initial getting into it. Because it's quite a big commitment, isn't it? Because your parents weren't particularly into hockey beforehand, were they?
No, not at all. I don't think they'd even been down to Cardiff and saw a game or anything. But yeah, at first I just got secondhand kit and just scripts and scraps and just seeing how it went. Because obviously hockey equipment isn't the cheapest starting up.
Yeah, of course.
So yeah, it turns out I liked it, and then I guess I built up my kit from there. And
so lucky that there was a system there like that in Cardiff at the time,
yeah,
where there was
lucky.
Different age groups and stuff. What was it like going through that system, and did many other people continue as well?
Yeah, we had a pretty decent junior team in Cardiff, and like we all grew up very close together, and we moved up through the ranks all together pretty much close-knit. There was a couple of guys come in and go out kind of thing, but
yeah.
There was a good, I'd say, 8-9 of us that were really good players, I'd say. And
is there anybody who's still playing in the elite league? Or
well,
in the,
there's the Chris Jones, who plays in Cardiff.
Of course, yeah.
So, yeah, me and him have been, like, really, really good. Like, we were always line mates in juniors, all the way up. So we're good friends. And there would be Michael Crisp, who backed up for Cardiff for a couple of years.
Of course, yeah.
Yeah, Tom Evans played a little bit in Cardiff. And then a couple just... Chris Hart played a couple.
Aye.
Games of Cardiff Devils as well.
So quite a few people managed to
yeah,
turn pro.
Yeah, and there's a lot that could have gone a long way, and obviously just took into the full-time work and other aspects of life.
So at what point, though, did you realise you're kind of going and it's like a good hobby to be involved in? At what point, how early did you think, I know I'd like to actually play this professionally, if I could do this, as this is what I do. What age were you when you thought that was possible?
I think I was, well, fairly early I was hoping that I'd be able to do it, and... Obviously, as it got on, I was coming to maybe like under 14s, under 16s, and I was starting to play with the seniors. And
yeah.
And I knew then that maybe I could try my hand at it professionally, and always wanted to see how high I could go. And yeah, worked into the Devils. I think I was 16 when I played my first game for the Cardiff Devils. So.
Wow. Yeah. What was that feeling like then? You must have been nervous.
Yeah, it was a pre-season game, I think, first of all, against, I think they were French.
Yeah.
So there was a couple. There was Tom Evans, I mentioned, Michael Hutchins as well. There was a couple, Jamie Hayes, a couple of youngsters.
Look, we should total disregard to that team, just some French team. Yeah, it was all about me concentrating on the game.
I can't remember which team it was. No, I think it was a French team. But if you said the name, I'd probably know it. But yeah, we played the warm-up games there, and I just started the season. I guess it was injury cover to start with, and then luckily there was quite a few injuries that year, and Jared Adams called me up for games, and I think... So 35 games maybe I played that season.
Wow. So what was that kind of like? I mean, at that point when you suddenly start playing, you know, for a team, for a professional team, was there anything else in your life that was the other option? Was there another avenue? Like if you weren't a hockey player, should you really been doing this? Did you have to persuade your parents not to go down that other route, and what was it?
No, I think they've always been very supportive of me with ice hockey.
Yeah.
At the time I was still in full-time education, so I was in sixth form.
Yeah.
So I was actually coming from practice and then going for the last two lessons at school.
Yeah.
Like before I was driving, so my parents would pick me up from the rink, drop me to school, and it was the other side of Cardiff as well. So like my teachers were really good with me, so I was just picking up lessons I'd missed.
Wow.
Like, I think I was missing half a lesson, so I just...
Were they like, you better be committed? That was my attempt. You knew I had to force in an accent at some point. I'm still working on it.
It's good. Yeah. Lots of it was coursework, so I was lucky, and the school were really good with me. So yeah, I was doing that an awful lot of time. And
if you hadn't done hockey, what else would you have done, do you think? Where would you be just now, do you think? Or was there literally nothing? Did you have to be that focused?
I don't honestly know, to be honest.
Did you ever fancy anything else?
Well, it was probably be sport orientated. I'd be honest. Like, I was always into the sport. Schools, I was trying to play all the sports I could, kind of thing. Yeah. Apart from rugby.
Really. There's a line.
Yeah, I didn't really play too much rugby. Like, a little bit when I was younger, but...
They've got plenty of them in Wales anyway, haven't they?
Yeah, I know.
You mentioned in the summer you often do, like, cycling. You're planning on doing some cycling this summer.
Yeah, hopefully. Like, Luke Piggott, who obviously plays in Cardiff as well, and he's a keen cyclist, so... I think hopefully we'll get out and do a charity run or two.
How far? How far are you going to cycle?
I think the one we're talking about is about 150k.
Cool. You're going to do it in the dark as well? That's the best time to do it?
Yeah, well, hopefully I'm finished before it turns dark. But if I'm not, I've had the experience.
You never know.
So, we've got... There's a guy who cycles for Team Sky. I think he's like helping us with a couple of equipment and recognition. So, yeah, it's going to be good. Hopefully we can do it for a good cause.
Oh, wow. Fantastic. Yeah, so. Well, I mean, you're not necessarily looking to play internationally for the cycling team because you got your Team GB call up. And what was that like when you first got your Team GB call up? Because it's one thing to play professionally, but then to represent your country must be something else.
Yeah, it was unbelievable. I think I went to Hungary the first year and it was a big tournament. Like, we were playing against some of the big teams, and it was a hell of an experience.
Were you expecting it at the time? When did it happen? You were at Cardiff at the time, weren't you?
Yeah. No, I'd had a good season or two, so I was hoping and hopeful that I would be in the team, and I missed out the year before. So, yeah, I was kind of happy and relieved the first year I got in. So, and then I had the next year, and then obviously just come back from Italy now. And it's unbelievable playing for the country. Like, I cherish it.
I remember chatting to you last year about when Matt Haywood got his call up just before it. I was talking to you about Team GB then. What was it like when you found out you weren't in that Team GB team? Was that a surprise that year, or how were you expecting that, and how did it feel?
Yeah, I wasn't really expecting it. No. It was tough to take, but you don't take it for granted, that's for sure. Mm. But it was tough to take and watch it, guys. But I didn't have the best of seasons either, so it's not something I can be like, well, I've been playing very well. Like, he takes who he thinks he's gonna do the best for the team, and he done there, and there's no grudges held. So.
Yeah. And do you feel that can help redouble your efforts over the summer? Because you worked really hard over the summer, didn't you? And you came in really good shape, and it seems to be paying off with some really good performances. I lost count of how many man of the matches and you've been getting from the fans as well.
Yeah,
it must be good.
It definitely helped feed the fire in my belly, should we say? And I was training hard in the summer and trying to get back in that team for Italy, and I did. So yeah, it was a nice achievement for me as well. It was tough, like I say, missing out, and then getting back in the team and putting a jersey on again was really good. So
now, obviously, after you got your Team GB call up, after that you ended up with another big move, which was leaving Cardiff, which was the place you've been in, you know, all your days, and then you've played with this team, you've gone through the youth system, and then the change comes about. Can you tell me about what happened with the change happening?
Well, I think it was 6 or 7 seasons I'd been in Cardiff.
Yeah.
So I was, I'd enjoyed all my years there. Like, it was a good experience, great memories. And it just got to a point on and off the ice a little. Like, I think everyone knows, like, it was a tough year in Cardiff that last year.
Yeah.
And it was, how to say it, it was like a good excuse. And I'd always wanted to play out of Cardiff at some point. Mm. So it was a nice time to get out of Cardiff, and I didn't know what direction the club was going in at that point. Mm. Braehead was obviously interested, and it looked like a great club to play for, and Glasgow seemed like an up-and-coming city. So, yeah, I chose to come here, and it's been a good 2 years.
Yeah, 2 years so far as well. I won't put the pressure on you to be coming back. I'll save that a little bit for the end of the interview. But it's a kind of tough one, though, I think. It's been interesting, the kind of last season was such a surprise season in many ways for the team. What was it like being part of that team and that drive towards what was nearly winning the Elite League, but then falling just that little bit short? What was that season like, and how was that ending like for you as well?
Yeah, well, obviously from the off we knew we had a good team, and we were playing away for the first couple of weeks as well, weren't we? And I think we went on a good run from the start.
Yeah.
And it just so I don't know when we went top, but we went top fairly early on. I'd say like Christmas time maybe.
How hard is that being a front runner?
I don't know.
Does it have an effect, do you think?
Yeah, it does. But I think positively.
Yeah.
I think yeah. I enjoyed being on top anyway.
Yeah.
So yeah, I think say from Christmas onwards, we were top obviously, and the games were going through, and we were still top, and things were looking positive, and obviously Sheffield caught us in the end, which was a tough one to swallow.
Yeah.
But yeah, I guess in the end, down the stretch, they won the games, and we look back at that Edinburgh game, and that was a tough one. I don't think anyone really turned up and performed very well. So.
Yeah. Do you feel like you get a bit more time on the ice as well, obviously, this season? And it can be one of those kind of things where it can be difficult for British guys in various teams if you're not getting the time. We saw the situation with Jordan County as well, really good player. And there's that choice where you either kind of go and try and find some ice time, or you play with these guys that are undoubtedly of, you know, an excellent standard as well. But you kind of had that choice early as well, didn't you? And you dropped down and played with some other teams to get the time.
Yeah, there's definitely a tough line there, I think. Like you say, I done it a couple of years back. Cardiff were going for the title. We were a very strong team that year.
Yeah.
And I wasn't getting the ice time. I was 10th forward at the time.
Yeah.
So I made a tough decision around Christmas time. It was January sometime. And we were in the middle of that Guinness World Record run. And I left to go to Basingstoke in the EPL. And the team ended up just missing out on the league title. So that was unfortunate for them. But it helped me because I think I would have just ended up staying the whole year sitting on the bench. And I went and played a first line power play and all like that. So, and I came back the next year and I actually had a good season. I think I scored 14 goals maybe. I had good point production, and I was playing a top regular spot.
Yeah.
So for me, it worked out, but I don't know, it's not an easy decision to make, and there's pros and cons of both sides. So I can, yeah, it's a tough one to decide, and there's no right or wrong answer either, I don't think. Well, coming from me anyway.
Well, I'll ask you an easier question then. Would you prefer doing interviews in the warmer or in the cold?
I feel like we're going to lose you.
I'd be freezing the whole time.
Yeah, you're not feeling the cold too much,
Yeah, but I've got another layer of man fat all over my body as well.
I've been shivering as well, and I think I was hoping the cameras didn't make it up.
I was nervous.
Well, I'll ask you under the stars. I'll ask you one last question under the stars. Then yeah. You're going to sign for the Clan next season or what? Then what's the deal?
I don't know yet. Obviously, it's still March time now.
Aye.
So it's coming up to the time where you start thinking about next season.
Aye.
But right now I'm just trying to focus on the end of this season and see how we do, hopefully a strong finish, and decide on next year then, yeah.
Sounds like a good idea. Should we go for a ride then?
Yeah, let's
do it. Do it. Yeah, okay, I've got the most out of you. Well, if you think this is cold, spare a thought for poor Tristan Harper, who we made do a topless hilltop photo shoot in minus temperatures. Have a look at this.
Let's go for it.
Tuned for stuff with the Braehead today. Got a little bit cold, topless on the ice today. It was good times though. Obviously had Gerry's dressing gown to keep me warm, which was nice.
Yeah, Tris, in the next couple of photos, could you make sure your nipples weren't protruding?
Yeah,
if you could bump on that for us, that'd be really
helpful. They could probably pierce some glass right now. They're that hard.
You did finish the photo shoot here, guys. Where's next?
Car park in the sky. It's going to get real cold, nice outside.
Some location shots.
A little frost in the ground here and there, but we'll manage.
This will be an inspiration though, because people can buy kilts and wear them to away games and look the part. So
absolutely, it'll be really cool.
It'll be good.
Yeah, it'll be awesome.
Let's get back.
Yeah.
Feel love, feel fair. Put your head on me if you dare. Such a woman.
So Tristan, we've done the photo shoot for the kill. Have you enjoyed the shoot?
It's been absolutely freezing. Yes and no.
Okay, well, we're just wondering if we could just do a couple more pictures with your top off, and we're just going to wait till it's dark and some frost. Is that okay?
No. Okay.
Okay, we'll wrap it.
You can go home.
Okay. Hey, abs look pretty cold, eh?
Yep. The things we do for the famous Braehead Clan. Did you know that we have a famous Hollywood star that supports the clan?
No.
And a Fox sportscaster as well?
No, I didn't.
Jay Baruchel and Owen O'Callaghan, big fans. I caught up with them last week.
Wow.
Well, guys, first of all, a big welcome to Glasgow.
Thank you so much. An honour to be here.
Pleasure, man. Fantastic.
Honour to be here.
Can you just give us a quick rundown on what you're doing over here? Not that you're not welcome, but what are you doing here?
Yeah, no, that's a valid question. No, we're in the process of shooting a movie called Celtic Soul, which is kind of about the shared sports and cultural history between Scotland, Ireland, and Canada. And, you know, all about immigrant saga, sort of where these kind of sports come from, sports fandom, passion, the sort of connection between football, hurling, and hockey, and all this stuff. And for me, it's just an excuse to come back to Glasgow because it's my favorite city outside of Canada. So.
Nice. Milk it for the audience.
Yeah, of course. Stuff, yeah. We know how to do this.
How did you guys meet up as well? So we've got a Canadian link and we've got an Irish link here as well. Yeah. How did you guys meet up then, Owen? How did you...
Well, I lived in Canada 3 years and I presented a nightly soccer show for Fox Sports.
Yeah.
And it went on every night for an hour each night. And unbeknownst to me, this guy watched it all the time. So we had this weird thing where I followed him on Twitter and I was like, oh, you know, I'm a big fan. And he responded by saying, oh, I'm a big fan of yours too. And I'm like, what?
it was my treat. Like the girl I was living with, when she goes to bed, I'd always have his show taped, and that was like my...
Wow, you were seeing him behind her back.
That's exactly right.
That's really weird. Yeah, I was
cheating on her with Owen every night.
Yeah, and I've just got married, so... And this feels like that I'm cheating on my wife with Jay. So it's kind of a full circle kind of thing.
And in a way, Owen, you're kind of cheating on football at the moment as well, with hockey, I see you then.
Yeah,
so are you a big hockey fan yourself?
Well, okay, I'll tell you a secret. As an Irish guy, our hockey kind of appreciation isn't the strongest.
Right.
But living in Canada 3 years, you kind of you're hell bent on figuring out just why this country loves this sport so much. So obviously I was there for 2010 in Winter Olympics. So Crosby in that moment, defining moment, the iconic moment is always in there somewhere. And you're in Vancouver, how often I had conversations with the Sedin brothers, with guys at the bar. So it kind of seeps in, you absorb a little bit. Yeah. But obviously through the course of doing this film, being in Montreal, visiting the Bell Centre, having this kind of really sacred moment together there for the purposes of filming.
You're being indoctrinated.
A little bit, yeah.
This is all a sham, really.
Totally, yeah, exactly.
Doing the best I can. No, it's our religion. Hockey's our religion. And for me, I call football the other side of my heart. So the two best games in the world as far as I'm concerned. And so, and I've watched this team from afar. I've had such an interest in British hockey for so long.
See, I was going to ask you about this. So the whole kind of Braehead Clan connection, where did it kind of come about then? So you've just been kind of hawking from distance.
Indeed, right, yeah. Okay. Yeah, well, just
online
because...
stalker.
Yeah, basically, yeah. No, I've been creeping. It's just because, like, we grow up surrounded by it. And so anything that's a kind of a different version of something familiar, I find very interesting, right?
Yeah.
And I'd much rather watch this than watch the KHL or something. So I just find this...
Take that, KHL.
...so much more entertaining. And it just is like... And what I love is that this team is one of the true... There's a legitimate fan culture here, right?
Yeah.
You know, like, this is why I said, When we bring Goon 2 to the UK, we have to bring it to Glasgow. That's where our premiere has to be, because this is where people actually watch the game.
Well, nice slip-in of Goon 2. Really subtle, liked it, but also fantastic news that it's going to be here then. That'll be the official launch.
That's right, the
and
UK premiere.
How much will the Braehead Clan feature in it?
Oh, that's a lot?
Yeah, oh, cool.
Okay, good.
That's
good.
What I was kind of hoping.
Good.
To be honest, that's the actual reason we're here.
Yes.
We got Sean William Scott waiting outside in the car.
Yeah, this is Goon 2, actually. It's a much smaller movie than the first one. It's just
budget,
this fucking guy with a camera and this idiot and then Owen.
Yeah. It's a roar movie. I like it.
Yeah, it's more Dogma 95.
Yeah, I'm Sean Standin, actually. Yeah, no, for the hockey stuff, Sean's not quite as good as I am. So, I take over.
That's actually not wrong either. Sean's a terrible skater.
Well, maybe we're hoping for Goon 3 then. You're doing your research.
That's right,
maybe
exactly that's right.
Well, guys, enjoy your stay. Thank you very much for taking an interest in the club, and long may it continue. And hopefully, to aid with that continuing,
yes, sir.
I've got a little prezi for you.
Holy
there we are.
Make
sure you've got the right one there. Some clan whiskey.
That's crazy.
Thank you. And we'll also sort you out some...
It says your name on it. Like, show the camera, bud. That's crazy.
Get a nice close-up of that, boys.
That's amazing.
And so if you could just down it in one before you leave, that'd be much appreciated.
Yeah,
thank you very much, guys.
No promises.
I think there's about half gone from mine already. So who's been at this?
Right. Cheers, guys. Beautiful. Safe trip. Thank you very
pleasure.
Much.
So much. It's honored to be here. For having thank us. You. Thank you.
Hey, come on, Gerry, hurry up.
Yeah, all right, I'm coming. All right, we can't all be professional athletes.
Ah, fantastic stuff.
We will, of course, keep you up to date with the details of that documentary when it's released, and the fantastic news that Goon 2 is going to be getting its premiere in Glasgow. Not bad, eh?
Yeah, it's not
great
bad
stuff.
At all.
Great stuff.
Yeah, shouldn't we draw the competition from last month?
Good idea. Yeah, of course, competition winner from last month. The question was, of course, when was the Necropolis opened, according to Brendan Brooks? When was the Necropolis officially opened? It was, of course, as we all know, 1833. The answer was A, 1833, and the winner of a signed clan jersey is Kaz at Doubleflub 19. Congratulations, Kaz. Make sure you contact Alex at BraeheadClan.com to pick up your prize. Now we should have another competition question for next month. The question is, what was the name of the first ever bicycle, according to Ben Davies?
According to me.
According to Ben Davies.
Yeah.
What was the name of the first ever bicycle? Was it A, the Dandy Horse, B, the War Horse, or C, the Fife Flyer? Was it A, or B, or C? And make sure you get all your elements in. As we said, you need to put at Braehead Clan. You also need to include the correct answer, and you also need to include the link to the show. You need all three elements, otherwise you won't be in the draw. Right, okay, we're running out of time here, so it's just time to have a quick look at the message board for this month. And on the message board, the big news is for the playoffs. Regardless of whether the clan make it or not, fingers crossed, but the Purple Army will definitely be there for the clan gathering. Wristband entry and top floor reserved at Squares in Nottingham. Join everyone from 7 p.m. Squares Nottingham for a fantastic night of fun amongst your fellow hockey family. It's a clan fan organised event, but everyone is welcome to join in regardless. And that is Friday, April the 1st, and the address is 6-9 The Poultry, Nottingham, Nottinghamshire. So looking forward to seeing everyone there in their purple attire. Not many fixtures left now on the calendar. Saturday the 12th of March, Braehead Clan entertain the Manchester Storm, a little chance at revenge there. The following night, Sunday the 13th, the return fixture down in Manchester. Saturday the 19th of March, Clan take on the Edinburgh Capitals. And the very next night, Sunday the 20th of March, the very last regular game of the season, Clan travel to Edinburgh.
Do you reckon we could go on now, Jay?
Yep, that's the end of the show. Until the next one, anyway.
Oh, you have to find some strange place to do the next one as well.
Yeah, probably like in a volcano or something.
Yeah, that'd be fun.
Yeah.
Who would you do for that one?
I don't know, who's got the fieriest temper?
Oh.
Probably have to, it's probably Kiefer at the moment, isn't it?